I believe there was some error on the printout. So it says composites, but I am not talking, going to talk on composite. So I will stick to the topic given to me. So just a word about what my talk will be about. I will try to be quick. So I will be briefly mentioning about IISc and SID and what we do at Times Square. And then I will be discussing a few engagement models. So getting started, IISc is the premier institute which has been number one for a long time. Though its name is Indian Institute of Science, actually 50% technology as well as engineering is even management. So there are more than 400 faculty, it's a big campus. And IISc has been behind many nation building efforts, the DRDOs were conceived there, IITs, ISRO, all of that. The founder of IISc is the great Tata, and his original founding statement was to provide advanced instructions to conduct original investigations, but he specifically had emphasized for the material and industrial welfare of the country. So this last part of the industrial welfare of India, though IISc has been doing it, if you remember, it was started in 1909 under British rule, and that was not something that they wanted to emphasize that much on. But now around 25 years ago, SID, which is Society for Innovation and Development, was set up to work on the industrial development part of the original founder's vision. And so there are various different projects that we work on. So more than 550 projects SID has worked on till now. And here is what three different departments of SID, and I am heading one of their departments, which basically works exactly on the problem areas that Dr. Saraswat has pointed, that our industries do not have R&D, new product development, system integration capabilities. So this is something that we started last year. And here I wanted to basically ask that, are there any micro, medium scale industries here? Small, micro and medium scale industries? Oh, there are a few. The rest I believe are MNCs, are representative of MNCs. How many people from other MNCs here and PSUs? Okay, so there is a distribution. So I was wondering, now giving background, my own background, I am an alumni from Indian Institute of Science. I am an engineer and also a product developer. Around 2008, I did master's post-graduation from IISc. Later on, I started consulting, and then I was working with Ministry of MSME, particularly for quite some time, for 4+ years. And I was wondering, what is the basic difference between large corporation and MNCs? So this is the definition of current MSME, is investment in plant and machinery. But that definition doesn't help us much. So this is a new kind of a definition that I have come up with. It basically plots the different companies. On one axis is the scale, and on the other axis there is the innovation. And MSMEs are here, which are traditional and small. And there are big, large corporations which have been traditional. They have become large in license era or even pre-license era. And the new companies are startup, which have a differentiator in the intellectual property itself, the technology that they have built up, that actually fuels their growth. So I will, I think, move onward, that most of the small scale industries expect that they will scale up their capital, their revenue, and then they will cross the innovation potential. So once they have enough revenue, they will start doing some R&D and maybe develop some proprietary technology that can fuel them. So that is the path that the most of the MSME think that they will take. What we are promoting is another path, where we support a MSME industry in developing core technology which is unique to themselves, which differentiate them in the market. And the potential of the technology is what actually gives it that momentous growth to the company, a path which typically startups take. Going forward, this point again got emphasized, that SMEs are not getting technology to them. There is no technology coming to them. So these are the different avenues through which technology can come to a MSME. But if you see that, internal R&D is largely missing in a MSME. Even if it is there, it is just a domain specific. Maybe they are making motors, they know everything about making motors, or they are making pumps, they know about that. But other disciplines, IoT, industrial IoT, data, how will they have other capabilities? Similarly, licensing will only give you manufacturing rights, mostly for which will be advantage to the company which is giving it to you. They are just using you for the labor power. Similarly, consultants are also very rare. Most of the engineering consultants are only into reverse engineering, and those who are consulting at a higher level, they are not affordable to SMEs. And partnership also mostly again are in the interest of MNCs. So NetNet, what we found is that the avenues which we can give SMEs a core sustainable business advantage by actually strengthening their technology competence are very few. So we are having various different ways that we will be working towards it. So I will skip this slide only to mention that the thing is that when you your business can operate at various levels, you can be using science as your growth vehicle, or technology, or human, or the engineering. The thing is that if you have developed a technology, that technology can branch out in multiple different products. So same technology can be put in lots of different products. For example, if you are you have developed technology of making blue LED lights. Now that blue LED enables you to make products in healthcare domain, in home lighting. The white lighting is actually coming because there is technology of emitting blue light. Ocean exploration, lot of different products can come out of it once you have the technology. And if you are able to invest in even deeper at this level of science, okay, that science behind the semiconductor which actually emits this light, that science has even broader applications. You can tweak the wavelength a bit and you can now have a LED which can actually kill microorganisms. And that opens up the entire market of water purification, air purification, and so on. So what we are enabling is that most of our industries are either operating in business operations. They have found that something is cheap in China, let's get it and sell it somewhere else. Or they get into reverse engineering, which is just you invest in reverse engineering for a year, you have opportunity window only 2 to 3 years because everyone else is also going to reverse engineer. So the money that you are putting in doing R&D, you just have 2 years to get money out of it. So this is the thing that we are saying, that you invest deeper, the research will take more time, but it will give you 10 years of time to actually exploit the technology. And science, of course, is never gets obsolete. So pardon me to be a little fast, but I think in the interest of time, I will do that. So when we think about business operations, there is, of course, on the right side, or the engineering, production, marketing, and sales, as well as visioning, strategy, partnership, collaborations, and R&D. Now, this is where our center helps. So this is the iconic Indian Institute of Science building, and oh, it's barely visible. It's a shell out of a factory. Something has to connect these two things together, and that connection is what we will emphasize on. So typically industries are strong in engineering, production, all of that, but not that strong on research, development, and those kind of activities. And institute, academic institute, any academic institute or research institute particularly, is strong on this side, but not strong on production. ISC, at the end of the day, the product of ISC is the people, the trained people. And at a time, just a trivia, that all the DRDO labs in India were being headed by ISC alum. So we have the vision, leadership as far as thought leadership is concerned, but we do not have the skills of putting products, launching products in the industry. So we need to strike this balance between visioning, R&D, figuring out what is the right product to do, and actually delivering it. So this, and then there are human resource elements everywhere. Okay, so it's a complex kind of a balance between the vision on one end and implementation on another end, and lot of people, and these people talk very different languages. So the way the scientists talk, the way businessmen talk is very different. So how to make them work together? In fact, this is the number one challenge of my department. If I tell you, we have the core thing which has been doing R&D with MNCs. So the MNCs, even Airbus, Boeing, all of them started their R&D actually by incubating with us, IISc, and then set up their own R&D center. The thing is, scientists from Boeing are working with scientists from ISC, same language, very full clarity. Startups, the kind of startups that we incubate, they are all scientists or technology and entrepreneurs. They already are either scientists or innovators, and then they work with us. But when we work with SMEs, the communication becomes a problem. And this is where Times Square comes in. So I am also a past entrepreneur and a technologist. So I have dabbled on both sides, and all the people in SID leadership have some startup experience or industry, are running industries as of now, and as well as they are faculty on in ISC. And the activity which actually connects all of these things together is new product development. Dr. Saraswat emphasized it many a times that this is the thing that we are missing. Multidisciplinary and even interdisciplinary. You cannot even say what activity lies in which discipline. And when we talk about new product development, here I can actually emphasize that India is lacking by a big, we are very, very behind. And one of the reasons why we are behind, that I have heard that in China there are 3,000 institutes which train in these fields. And in India there is only one. So I am fortunate to have done my post-graduation there, which is Center for Product Design and Manufacturing in IISc, where we are trained new product development. And the students are of course selected very rigorously. They are from all different disciplines, all disciplines of engineering as well as architecture, and the courses are in management, they are in technology, they are in design, aesthetics, so new product development and finance as well, new product planning, business. In fact, I am taking some of the courses there now, assisted by other industry people. Okay, so this is the name of the department. Now I am coming to, and I will skip this portion. So these are the different ways that we collaborate with industry. So there are some direct collaboration. We work with the industry and we actually handhold them till the product is launched. And then there are some ecosystem activities as well that we do, because everything said and done, if you don't have these capabilities, you cannot be developing. So we do both, but this I will be skipping. Actually, my manager Pratap Murthy is here. He can explain that in detail. He is there for the entire day. So I will move on. Now, this is where the need for collaboration is, that any business, so this is the business or company, I have called it industry in this image, it needs technology flow as well as financial flow. And to develop technology as well, you need financial flow. And finally, the purpose of the industry is to create some value for the end customer. And once the value is transferred to the customer, there is some transaction, of course, the income or revenue, which gets captured back to the industry. Now, what we are seeing here, that there are loopholes or weaknesses at all these points. Our industries are not able to have that much margin because we are doing menial work. We don't have enough margin to actually put money in investing in the growth of our company beyond 5 years. If you don't do R&D, if you don't invest in foresight, you will only be balancing your annual sheets, nothing more than that. But there are all these, and technology flow, where will the technology come from? As I illustrated, it is not going to come from someone else. If it is for your own benefit, you have to develop it yourself. So now I will come to the topic of engagement models. Now, looking at all of these problems, I will be telling what kind of engagement models are possible. So, simplistic engagement model is bi-party, in which the industry and Times Square together comes, we come together to develop a particular kind of a product, and that development happens through relevant programs. What we are developing and how we are developing is there. But the model is this, that industry and us, Times Square, we both co-invest in that development, even financially, where the lead of developing the technology is more towards ISC, by ISC. But it's very important to note that each activity that we start at Times Square, we are always market first. We'll first verify whether there is value in the market, whether someone is the idea worth developing. We don't want to develop something because it is just cool and we are going to find it very exciting to develop. I am also a technocrat, but okay, that was long time back. If the idea is worth doing, only then we do it. And so we have to validate whether the customer actually sees value in this. Not only that, many other factors are there. People keep on cribbing that we made all of this thing and politics happened, I did not get job order. Thing is that all those politics exist as of today, they are facts. We have to understand that how is the decision making process happening, whoever our customer is, whether it is B2C consumer or B2 government or B2B. And in our model, which if time permits I will explain, we get the end customer also together, and only when we figure out that yes, there is a enough stake, there is some even the skin in the game, in the case of B2G or B2B, the industry should also invest. That comes to the second kind of engagement model, tri-party, where the industry, the person who, and their client are co-investing. Okay, so they can co-invest in few different ways. One is that they give the assurance of buyback, that once this development has happened, there is already some advance and we are going to buy with you. And maybe the L1 kind of a thing is relaxed. If you are developing it for me, certainly I am going to buy from you. This kind of comfort, if the client gives, it gives a tremendous amount of confidence to the industry that yes, I am going to develop something, I am going to spend 1 or 2 years of my precious time, but I am assured that the client is going to buy it. So this is the second model, which is a tri-party kind of a agreement. Right at the onset, when we onboard the end client, the end client can be Boeing, it can be Airbus, it can be even a defense service, but we together come to an agreement that the requirements, ISC will actually satisfy the requirements of the end client. Now this is more relevant in defense, that many times because government is purchasing, they are not confident to give multi-crore project to a private partner just like that. Even when the authority has a signing authority, it has not been done that much time before. So the one guy who is head of maybe Air Force, for example, if he sticks his neck, he perceives that he will be in deep trouble. But what we do here, that we engage multiple times and reduce the risk a lot. Okay, so lot of work will happen even before the agreement is signed. Okay, and then the agreement can be like this, that ISC will be heading, meeting the requirement of the industry, of the defense or government, and the agreement mentions that if those requirements are satisfactorily met, the order surely goes to the industry who has also partnered here. So this is one of the models. So funds come from, and we will always be co-investing as well. Then there is a possibility of multi-party. Not many complex developments can happen with only one industry heading it. So the multi-party, in fact, I will tell you, this is where it starts getting complicated. A big system, even a satellite system, will have multiple industries. So what we do is that we have been pitching it to various defense services, that we develop a team of industries, MSMEs or otherwise, other industry partners, who will take up subsystems, and all the integration of that is done by the system integration. We identify one of those industries to be system integrators, and the system integrator, as long as the development is happening, is ISC. But as soon as we are post development, one of the industries which is pre-identified becomes the system integrator for supplying. So this is the transaction transition which happens there. And okay, there are some specifics, I should skip that. So the entire model ends up becoming something like this. In fact, this was one of the Air Force has come to us. They had this problem that have different manufacturers for all the subsystems of the product, but their problem was that all these manufacturers have to work together. So imagine a legacy subsystem which has to be now upgraded. And let's just for example, there is a electronic circuitry there, and there is the cooling system. Now what is happening, that there is an industry which can certainly make all the electronics required, and there is also an industry which can make all the cooling required. Now the problem which Air Force was facing, that they are inflexible. The electronics guy will say, I will only make this. Let the cooling guy figure out whatever way he want to cool. The cooling guy says that with the kind of requirements that you want, this is the best electronics cooling system, let the electronics guy do and confirm. So these interfaces is where all the problem is happening. And Air Force is not able to be the apex body to do that, because then there will be complaints of Air Force favoring one industry versus other. Plus, does Air Force have the technical competence to actually figure out what is the best for the entire system? We talked about multidisciplinary optimization. Who will do that? So this is the model in which we take, I think barely readable, but this is the part of the team that we have. We are people from various different specialties, and we basically specification control board with the end client also. And then there is a chief execution committee headed by one person who will be actually lead of the project. And then there are separate group of companies which are working on separate subsystems. So this is one of the models. And the next model is multi-party, multi-project kind of a thing. It's just a scaling of the earlier model in which multiple such projects are working in tandem with multiple companies. So this we had been pitching to Air Force as well as Navy, and it is going forward much faster with Navy, that they set up a actual product DPI, product innovation center at ISC, where multiple such projects exist, and there is a different committee, and the director ISC himself is part of the steering committee. So here I will I think, how am I on time? I will maybe I will just tell two words about this, that how we do that, the actual work. So the work happens by new product development. It can happen with students at ISC, it can happen with your employee, it can happen with all of us together, but it happens through multiple rounds of prototyping. Okay, and the other thing is product innovation center, which is actually physically your design department exists in or incubates, is incubated within ISC. Now this incubation is not for startups. This is the incubation for a company who is very strong in production, marketing, sales, all of that, but does not have a in-house design capabilities. And they need to set up a new capability of how to design products. So this engagement is what our main focus is, that we handhold you right from putting a team together, even before that identifying what is worth doing. Okay. And then handhold you through the entire process. Here the objective is not that we license you technology at the end of the day. That will also happen. In fact, multiple products will get launched in the span of 2 years. The main highlight is that at the end of the 2 years, the entire capability of developing new product is shifted to your company. And your people, we will be confident that they, because they have launched multiple products, you are confident as a owner of your company, that any breakthrough that happens in ISC or anywhere else at a lab level, your team is able to actually figure out whether it makes commercial sense and put it to the market. So this is what our main aim is, and that we started last year. This year we are already expecting a few product launches. So first year, there are a lot of videos. If you connect with me, I will even pass that information to you. And lot of events we have started conducting. Lot of industries from Hyderabad has also participated last year, the summits that we have done. And this is the last thing, so it's kind of a continuum. And how to engage is basically written out here. Particularly today we are opening up the defense innovation thing. So there is a expression of interest form, so you can download and fill it. And we are always accessible, so you can call us. I will share my contact details as well. And just 2 minutes on this, that how we actually do that. Now we are talking about getting a lot of different species to talk together. How does that work? First of all, what we start with is a strategic possibility assessment and collaborative engagement sessions. What it basically means, the strength of your company and your network, the strength of ISC and our network, if all of our forces are combined, what all can we achieve? And that is the synergy. It will be much more than what you can do just by being yourself. And this approach is basically which gets us to, so all these things happen here. And how we should work together, who all should be our strategic partners, okay, out of all the different, whether we should go for a low hanging fruit or high hanging fruit. Okay, your high hanging fruit might be something that you cannot actually invest in, but can you get your client in? So if your project requires that, if I get a some kind of confirmation from, let's say, Navy, that yes, we are behind you, I will put my money. Or maybe even more than that, that if Navy, there is technology development funds and other things, we get all together, we get into a room, we understand their concerns as well. Everyone's concerns here are actually very, very meaningful. If you put yourself in the shoe of the procurement officer, his constraints are real. And there are plenty of people in the mechanism. Though we think that there might be corruption and other things also exist, I think a lot of good things are happening. Identifying the right channel, all that is also part of it.